I just wanted to comment on something that the town manager wrote to us in the packet. I guess it generally falls under correspondence, and there was correspondence from the town manager to us in the packet regarding Hanford Cove Road. That the fact is that they are now going to be placing in 2 weeks down one of the initial pavements. So that right now they're taking up all the old pavement, and they're going to be placing the initial pavement down in 2 weeks. And I just wanted to once again thank the residents of Hanford Cove Road for their extreme patience on this matter. And now as we're getting into spring and the mud season, we can see the light at the end of the tunnel, and I wanted to express to them my gratitude for being so patient on a very long and sometimes trying project. So just wanted to give an update on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. The manager?
Just one quick thing. That is now 1 week. It was 2 weeks when I wrote the note.
Oh, good.
It's still due for April 18th. The Public Works has been busy trying to get ready and succeeding, so now due for the 18th if the paving company comes through, which is a holiday, somewhat of a holiday, by the way. I'd also like to bring the council up to date on the school budget. Mentioned last week at a special meeting that you had that the school board was reviewing their budget. They subsequently reviewed it again on Saturday morning. What they've come up with for a recommendation to the town council is a tax increase of 55 cents. It's floated about up and down. At this point, it is 55 cents. Combined with the budget that I recommended to the town council, which would if enacted, provide for a 50 cent increase, now makes a total out of the recommended budgets of $1.05. That's about an 8.2% increase from the current tax rate of $12.70.
Thank you, Mike. We have to approve the minutes of the March 14th meeting.
Madam Chairman, I move we adopt the minutes of the March 14th meeting as written.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. And the minutes of the March 24th meeting.
So moved approval, Madam Chair.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. We now have four public hearings tonight. And what we think is the best thing to do is to take up each item on our agenda after the public hearing on that item. So we will begin with the Sunday liquor sales in agency stores. And Debbie is going to, our town clerk is going to tell us about the warrant.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The purpose of this public hearing this evening is so the citizens of Cape Elizabeth can express their opinions and comments on the issue. The town council is just providing the public forum for this, so there will be no action taken by the council this evening. The actual item or the actual referendum question will be on the Tuesday, May 3rd election. And just for the benefit of the people, I'd just like to read the actual referendum that will be on the ballot. This is provided by Title 28 in the Maine revised statutes. It states, sale of liquor for the consumption off the premises on Sundays. Shall this municipality authorize the State Liquor Commission to permit the operation of state liquor stores and agency liquor stores and to issue licenses for the sale of liquor to be consumed off the premises of licensed establishments on Sundays? If the vote passes, it will need a majority of the votes cast on the liquor option question. If a majority of votes are not cast or it is a tie vote, then the liquor referendum question will not pass.
Thank you, Debbie. Now we'll open the public hearing on Sunday liquor sales in agency stores. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak in favor of this item? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? You mean you're all here? And Mr. Adams.
My name is Henry Adams, resident of the town of Cape Elizabeth. I have two reasons to be here tonight to oppose the Sunday sale of hard liquor in the IGA. The second reason, is very eloquently spelled out in the Cape Courier, Volume 1, Number 3, Page 3, in a letter that was written by Loretta Pond. And I think that every voter in the town of Cape Elizabeth has a duty to read this letter before they cast their vote. And I'm very proud to announce that the author is here tonight. The other issue, I think, is more fundamental. I said this back on the 14th of March when I was here discussing the beer license for the Cape Elizabeth House of Pizza. I think the citizens of Cape Elizabeth should examine their conscience. This is the time when we've got Mothers Against Drunk Driving. This is the time when we have CAPASA. This is a time when we've got a multitude of organizations that are trying to reduce drunk driving. This is a time when the state legislature is debating reducing the threshold for OUI from 0.1 down to 0.08. And I think it'd be very irresponsible for the adults of this community to send the wrong message to the youth of this community. And I feel that we don't need an additional burden in the town of Cape Elizabeth on the Sunday sale of liquor. And I urge you to read the article in the Cape Courier. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak either for or against this local option referendum question? Nobody? Then I will declare the public hearing on this item closed, and we will take up item number 69 to consider approving the warrant for the May election, which includes the local option referendum.
I move that we approve the warrant for the May election.
Second.
Is there any discussion?
Do we have the date in there, too?
The date is May 3rd. The polls are open from, Debbie?
7 a.m.
to 8 p.m. on May 3rd. And the election, the voting will be held at the high school.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? Thank you, it's unanimous. We will move on now to the second public hearing regarding the miscellaneous offenses ordinance. Bill Jordan is chairman of the ordinance committee, and would you like to make a brief presentation, Bill?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Yes, I would like to make just a couple of brief comments in section 12-14, that's one. No person shall disturb any public meeting, singing, school, entertainment, or meetings of any kind. And in there before, we had evening meetings. So now we're just taking out evening and having it for any meetings. And then I'll save the biggie to last. Then there's a change as far as fires at the fort. And it says here, no person or group of persons shall use nor facilitate other than provided by the town and shall burn no fuel other than charcoal or charcoal briquettes. However, any underwriter's laboratories, listed gas grills or appliance with a gas cylinder of no larger than 20 pounds. The reason that's put in there, that we didn't want them using 100-pound cylinders down there and things like that, so we thought it would be wise if we kept them down to the cylinders that most everybody is familiar with, and that's the 20-pounders. In section 12-3-5-3, it's the opening hours of the fort, and it's what it does is It gives the employee or the agent within the rights to grant by their leasee and exceptions during the special events approved by the town council. What this really does is just let somebody's lease it to be able to stay there a little while longer and clean up and pick up and go out after the forge closed. And the other one that I guess most everybody is here for is a curfew. And it has been brought to the ordinance committee's attention after we posted it for a public hearing last time that maybe the ordinance should go, period. And I believe there is some people here that might see it both ways. And what it says now, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, is no child under 16 years of age shall be on or remain upon any public or private street, way, or land which he is not a resident or an invited guest. And it goes on and gives the hours from 9 p.m. to 5 a.m., from May 1st to October 31st, and 8 p.m. to 6 a.m. from November 1st to April 30th. And Madam Chairman, I would like to propose an amendment to this when we get ready to act upon it.
All right. Well, this is the opportunity for the public to make itself heard. So is there anyone who wishes to comment on the curfew ordinance or any of the other ordinances that we're considering?
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Carson?
Could we have the police chief comment on the opinions of the police department or the value of the curfew ordinance, please?
Chief Pickering? Just very briefly, as
Excuse
I stated.
Me, Chief. There are people standing in the rear, and I just want to point out that there are plenty of seats up front. I know how human nature hates to be seated up front, but there are seats up here. Excuse me.
You might explain, Chief Pickering, the difference with or without the ordinance or how it might be used.
Basically, this ordinance is numbers of years old. It was enacted, I guess, in the 1960s. We haven't had occasion to use the ordinance in my recent memory, and I probably wouldn't expect that we would have reason to use it in the near future. However, I would regard it as a tool that we could look to if situations arose where we had large groups of juveniles on the street. I do want to offer to you that we do have state laws that we also can look to for some judgment in this area also. I think the real reason it was enacted in the first place is at that time had large groups of people who were disruptive, who were younger. It was a way that we could take care of that problem without a formal charging instrument, which we would look to now to attack those issues. In other words, through state laws, through juvenile intake laws and the like. As I've stated in other meetings and privately to most of you, I'm not going to fight vehemently about this ordinance. I do think it's a good tool. I'd hate to see it taken out completely. And I would ask that if it was to be sent back to the ordinance committee, perhaps it could be adjusted, the hours amended, or some other prescriptions put in there that wouldn't completely take it out of the ordinances. And maybe it could be amended to that extent. I'll be interested to see what Councilor Jordan has for amendments before I would speak further on it.
Madam Chairman, in the interest of making more information known to the public so that maybe they might comment, could I direct another question to the Chief?
Sure, go ahead.
Could you maybe explain, I had a little conversation with the social studies class before I sat down, which is prompting me to ask the questions maybe for them so that they will get some more information, because the few that I talked to are not against this ordinance. But if there was a large, first of all, does it refer to just residents of Cape Elizabeth, or could this be used if there was a large group of young people here that were not residents of Cape Elizabeth?
I don't know exactly if it does refer specifically to Cape residents.
Okay.
I would assume that would be the first people that would be affected by it.
Okay. Now, if you had a large group of people collected that were disruptive in some way, or which was deemed to be disruptive, and you did not have this ordinance as a tool, even though I know you have not used the ordinance and hasn't been used for many years, but you needed to break up that group and it was not breaking up. If you were, for one reason or another, to take one of those young people to the police station because you didn't have the ordinance, that would mean, this was based on our previous discussion, you would have to book one of those people, because the state law, that's the only way that you could break this up then, is because you would use a state law.
Yeah.
And that you would have to book one of the young people, which means that means the picture taken and all that. What does that mean?
It would be a more formal charging instrument, as I mentioned earlier. We'd take them through juvenile intake. It's a private process. It's not public because the people would be juveniles in that particular case. Where I see an application of this particular ordinance, perhaps, would be, let's say, Halloween night, when there are typically large groups of younger people out. Obviously, it wouldn't be in our best interest to charge them formally, to take them back to the station, to release them to their parents in a formal type situation. And I haven't seen that problem has escalated in the last several years during Halloween night. That might be one situation where we could at least employ this ordinance to protect us liability-wise and civilly, to get juveniles off the street, take them back to their homes, call their parents in, things of that nature.
Okay. Any other questions of Chief Pickering while he's here? Is there right? Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on this ordinance? Nobody else? All these people? All right, then. If there is no further public comment, I will... Yes?
What is this issue?
This is the a group of ordinances called Miscellaneous Offenses, and what we are talking about is curfew for children under 16. Did you have any comment? All right, if there is no further public comment, we will close the public hearing. And Councilor Jordan?
Madam Chairman, the amendment that I would like to run it by the chief and get his feelings, if I may, but the amendment that I would like to impose here, when nowadays a majority of the children 15 years of age have driver's license and what have you, and 16 also, they most all have driver's license. I would like to move that down a year and say no child under the age of 15 years would have to comply with this ordinance. What would be your feeling there, Chief?
An excellent compromise, I guess. I don't see any real problem with that. I wouldn't expect that would change our philosophies on the enforcement of that ordinance either. But it would give that extra year latitude, which I think would be appropriate in this day and age.
Thank you. Well, I hadn't worked on that.
Any other comment? Councilor Carson?
I wondered if the ordinance committee had discussed maybe changing the hours. Is 9 o'clock realistic? I mean, I just had this interesting conversation with these students here, and these particular students were not opposed. You could see both points of view, but they were the ones who suggested maybe that the hour should be adjusted. We didn't talk particularly about the age, but maybe that the hour, if anyone was interested in that.
Councilor Torrey?
I don't know whether Councilor Jordan actually has offered an amendment, but I am willing to offer an amendment at this time. And I guess, being that none was officially offered yet, I'll just put mine out there. And what I would like to do is offer an amendment to delete Article 3, which is the article entitled Curfews, from this section of miscellaneous ordinances. And I'd like to make a couple of comments as to why I've made the motion to amend to delete. What it has to do for me is one of the very essential freedoms in our society is the freedom of movement. And I believe that the freedom of movement is protected for all citizens, whether they're young citizens or whether they're old citizens. It's one of the basic tenets or ingredients of our democracy. We have presently in this town a curfew that makes it literally illegal for a citizen under 16 to walk to the grocery store to buy a loaf of bread and walk back. Now, I grant you that the police hasn't abused this law, nor have they enforced it very much, or maybe even at all. But the fact that it's on the books makes me very uncomfortable, makes me very nervous, and I'd like to see it removed because it could be used for discretionary purposes later. I don't like to see a law where it's illegal for a 15-year-old, very well-behaved, excellent young person to walk to the store. This type of thing These are the type of what I call archaic laws that I'd like to see removed. A few other points quickly that I'd like to make. There are other numerous laws that are on the books that the police department could use. Absolutely no question. One of them is the failure to disperse. If a crowd is being disorderly and they don't disperse, that's against the law. Disorderly conduct is also against the law. If there's a problem with some teen parties, I believe that most of them are probably being caused by people over 16, so this law wouldn't apply to them. But even then, there are laws that are applicable. So we're not taking from the police department or from our town management the ability to enforce laws. I don't want people to get that idea. But what we are is opening up some chance for freedom of movement for some of our younger citizens that also have rights. I also would like to point out that I'm positive that this council would enact emergency curfews if it ever came to be that was what was needed, emergency curfews. And in my opinion, we've seen curfews used throughout the ages in emergency situations, and I think they're applicable in emergency situations. We're not presently in one in Cape Elizabeth. Thus, I'd like to see the curfew lifted for that reason as well. I guess, basically, to wrap it up, what I would say is the majority of the young people in this town are law-abiding, excellent citizens. I know many of them that are under 16, and I say let's give them an opportunity to prove how good they are. Let's protect their rights, and let's delete this entire section from the miscellaneous offenses.
Any further discussion? Councilor Carson?
I thought Councilor Jordan was trying to speak.
Councilor Jordan?
I guess I am certainly in a minority to speak on this issue, and I guess I won't try and kill myself to get it passed because I can see that there's nobody else that's going to agree with me. But it was interesting to speak with the students about this, and I guess that they've had some discussions about it. I'm sure that there's some different points of view in the student group, not just this group, but the students at the high school, or maybe at the middle school too. There's going to be two sides of the issue. I was very interested to see that they didn't leap all over it and say, oh my gosh, how come it's there? That's terrible, that's terrible. I think that over the years, we have taken certain responsibilities away from authorities to keep law and order in our society. And this is a tool that has been there and has not been used because there has not been need to use it. I just didn't see any point that it was necessary to remove it. I listened to the police chief. I listened to his comments the other day. I didn't think it caused any problem. I certainly have faith that we as a town will hire police officers and have a police department that will run in such a way that they will not take rights away from young people within this age limit. And I assume that we will continue to have a police department that will work that way and we'll hire policemen to work for us. So I was in favor of leaving as it is. I'm in favor of what Councilor Jordan put as an amendment. I will see how this vote goes first, and then maybe we can offer that amendment to the 15 or below, which would then eliminate some of the students because the rest will have the driver's license and will have more freedom. And then maybe if the Councilor Latore's motion does not pass, we can certainly look at the time of it as well. But there may be some adjustments that we can make to leave the tool for the police department to use if they are needed. I'm interested to see, because I do not have my copy in front of me, does this apply to young people who are not citizens of Cape Elizabeth? It just says people, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It says residents or invited guests.
Residents or invited guests. So maybe we can make some adjustment in that for the police department. I know that they have had some problems with large groups of young people collecting and causing problems, and they are not residents of Cape Elizabeth. They come from other towns.
May I read it?
Yes.
Because I don't think it does mean a resident of Cape Elizabeth.
Okay.
It says, no child under 16 years of age shall be or remain upon any public or private street, way, or land at which he is not a resident or an invited guest or in any place open to the public except for a duly scheduled public event in the town in the nighttime between and then the hours.
Okay,
so it doesn't sound to me as if we're talking about just residents.
Okay, thank you. And one more comment as response to Councilor Latore. It's hard for me to believe that we at this point at any time will have a police department who's going to stop some youngster from walking to the store to get a soda. I mean, that is just an unreasonable thought to think that that's even going to happen.
I imagine that if that were to happen, we would just would not have that police department here anymore. We'd have a different group. So I urge us to think it through carefully.
Councilor Emerald?
Well, I think we've had an ordinance on the books since 1969 that has not been used, then I don't think we need it. Maybe no police officer would arrest a young person walking to the store after 8 o'clock in the winter or after 9 o'clock in the summertime. However, they should, according to our ordinance, because it's illegal. And I just think that the ordinance doesn't make sense. That it's overly restrictive, it's not enforced, and it's not enforceable. I don't think we should keep an ordinance like that.
Chief Pickering, if I may I ask you a question or two? I know there is a state law about loitering. Could you describe that to us and what your enforcement possibilities
are? Very simple
are?
State law. Anyone that's in a public area and asked to move along does not be guilty of the crime of loitering and could be taken into custody and prosecuted for that.
They have to be taken into custody. Is that right?
Not necessarily. They can be summoned.
Discretionary.
Yes, it is.
And what about the no drinking in public places?
Are you getting the point that all laws are discretionary and up to the authority either to prosecute or not? There's only one law on the books that I'm familiar with, there may be more, that absolutely require arrest, and that is the state laws relative to domestic violence, which demand that police officers arrest people in a domestic violence situation where we expect the violence to reoccur. We are compelled to arrest people in those situations. There are other laws that do require that, but for the most part, all of our laws and ordinances are discretionary to a certain extent.
Good, thank you. Councilor Carson?
Could I ask a question? We have on the books presently, I don't know if it's, we have a state law pertaining to loitering. Is that something that you invoke very often?
From time to time we do, yeah.
Okay, so that is a state law that is just used occasionally, but we do have it on the books.
That's correct. Obviously, if someone comes up and the two parts of that law is that they're asked to move along, and if they do, there's no violation has occurred. If we go back in a few minutes and those people are back, that charge is no longer necessary. We no longer have to ask them to move along. They're in violation of that law, and they can't either be summoned or arrested at that point. But all of our laws are discretionary to a certain extent. There's a law in the books which requires people to sound their horn upon passing during daylight hours. I'm sure all of you here have done that today.
So actually, there's a law on the books that we don't invoke, we don't use, we don't enforce, but we leave it there.
Councilor Tinsman.
I just wanted to speak in favor of the removal of Article 3 on the curfew ordinance. Basically, for reasons stated earlier, but it does send a mixed reaction or a mixed signal to the youth that we're trying to pass ordinances that are not enforceable. And yet when it comes time to enforce them, then perhaps unless it has a strong history of enforcement, then it could be taken out of context or good discussion as to why it was used in that instance. I do think we have other laws pertaining to dispersal. I do think that ordinances like this are temporary in nature to deal with a temporary problem. And I would think that if we needed to enact a curfew ordinance, it would be a good time to sit down with the police department to find out what the problem is, to address a temporary solution to it, perhaps a long-term solution other than a curfew to restrict movement of youth. I would just hope that the rest of the council would strike this and that we could get on with some other ordinance reviews. And there may be some other ordinances as we get through that are outdated and subject to review.
No, go ahead, let Lester do it.
Councilor Lester Jordan.
I'd just like to ask a question. If we pass, I don't know, can we pass this amendment tonight, or does it have to go to public hearing again? Would we have to table this and then introduce the amended portion to a public hearing, or can we just make the amendment?
That's a friendly amendment.
Our town attorney is here. Let's ask him that question.
I believe you could delete
some portion of the group of ordinances before you and not require another public hearing. In other words, the public hearing was scheduled for all those ordinances, and I think you can delete, because it was properly publicized for tonight. I don't think you could add new ordinances, but I think you could delete portions or all of those individual ordinances.
Well, I sort of gathered that we could delete it, but what about the amendment that was introduced?
Changing the hours.
Or changing the age.
The age.
Would we have to go to a public hearing before we enacted on that?
I think you've had a public hearing tonight, and I don't think it's necessary. I think there's a balance that has to be struck, that there are modest amendments that can be made after a public hearing without having to have another public hearing. We've given that opinion before and stand by that. I think that age would be one that's modest enough not to require an additional public hearing.
Thank you, Tom. Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I'm opposed to the amendment. I believe it's something that I know we've had on the books, and I remember back when it was enacted, and it was enacted for a purpose, and it really served a purpose. It's something there that we have on the book that it can be used if it's needed to be used, and I think there's a lot of other little laws and ordinances that are on the books that are the same way. You don't use them every day, and the chief brought out a good one just a minute ago. And I don't see any harm if the law is not abused, and that why it can't be carried on the books, and I don't think that it's doing any harm to anyone. And I was interested in what Councilor Carson had to say about talking to the school children, that they weren't uptight about doing away with this, and they could see both sides of it. And I think it's something that we as a council should carry it and continue to have it on the books and not be a council that has to act on reactions. Because if something happened next year and you needed an ordinance, we'd be back here and acting a special ordinance to take care of the issues. I don't think that's the proper way of doing it. Let's think ahead of something that might come up, and it's there to use if you need it. And it's a lot of a lot of other laws and ordinances on the books. If you had them all in a nice thick folder, you wouldn't dare to get up and go out of the house in the morning because you'd be illegal. So I would hope that this amendment is defeated.
Any further discussion? Then we have an amendment before us and a second to delete this particular article, Article 3 of the Miscellaneous Offenses Ordinance. And if there's no further discussion, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor? Opposed? It's 5-2. Thank you. So the amendment has been adopted, and now I believe it's in order to adopt the remainder of the ordinances. Would you like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to that effect. I'll raise my little hand.
Is there a second?
Second.
I'd like to suggest you also include in that and to renumber the ordinance accordingly.
That's right. If we delete this particular article, then we will have to renumber the rest of the ordinance.
Okay, I understand.
And you include that in your motion.
Yes, that's true.
Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? So it's 6-1, Debbie. Thank you. Now we will move on to the third public hearing, the Harbor Advisory Committee report. Do I see the chairman of the Harbor Committee in the audience? Mr. Coggeshall. You want to say a few words?
As the members of the council will recall, at
Bruce,
last
month's... Bruce, would you identify yourself?
Excuse me. My name is Bruce Cogsall. I'm the chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Harbor Advisory Committee. As the members of the council will recall, and as I'll summarize my report again for the people that are here that weren't here at last month. The committee has been in existence since November of last year and has to date focused its attention on Kettle Cove. And as we all know, Kettle Cove is the area that's at the end of Crescent Beach and is actually part of the Crescent Beach State Park. And in addition to Kettle Cove itself, there is a small town-owned access to Crescent Beach, which is just north of the parking area. And except for Fort Williams, this little access road onto the beach is the only town-owned access to the water in Cape Elizabeth and the only public boat launching area owned by the town. Kettle Cove is a very limited facility with many, many demands made upon it by the people who want to use it. And in dealing with the problems at Kettle Cove, which I'll address in just a moment, our approach has been to not encourage any increase in the intensity of the use of that facility, but to better manage the existing use that's made of the facility. And it's in managing this facility, it is the problem is further complicated by the fact that the state owns the facility, and that places limits on what the town can do there. And I'll comment more on that later. At Kettle Cove, the principal problems we've identified are, one, competing demands on the boat launching area between the commercial fishermen and people with pleasure craft. Two, a lack generally of a launching area for small boats. Three, there's a parking problem, both in the area called Stump Cove. There's a problem with parking on the beach. There's a problem of parking in the paved parking area. And four, there's a problem of a general lack of supervision of the area. In attempting to deal with these problems and approaching these issues, the committee has given primary consideration, I think, to the needs of the commercial fishermen who have used this area for many, many years to launch boats and to bring the catch up out of the water. We have submitted our preliminary report to the council, and I just want to summarize very briefly what our recommendations are. One is that we designate the Stump Cove area, and for those of you that don't know what that is, Stump Cove is the gravelly area to the right of the parking lot that slopes down to the water. We recommend that area be designated primarily for commercial fishing activities, and that the town access onto the beach, which is north of that, be used for launching pleasure boats. We've recommended that the town adopt a permitting system where residents of the town can get an annual permit which would permit them to launch a boat at the Kettle Cove area, a pleasure boat. There'd be two permits, one for pleasure boats, one for fishing boats. The pleasure boaters would be entitled to go across the town access, launch on the beach. The people with a fishing permit would be entitled to launch it at Stump Cove and to park their vehicles at Stump Cove. We recommended that appropriate signs be installed designating the two launching areas and the parking area. We recommended that an attendant be hired to be there primarily during the summer months to enforce the parking rules, to assist people in getting to the appropriate place to launch their boat, and to see that the regulations are followed down there. And finally, we've recommended that there be better enforcement down there, particularly at nighttime, where the place has become an area for teenage kids to hang out. The park ranger has described to me what a Sunday morning there looks like, having to clean up broken bottles, beer cans, and the like. And we're recommending that simply we have a little better enforcement in that area. Don't permit drinking, and don't permit parking at night. I met last week. You recall it at the last council meeting, I indicated that we had to resolve some problems with the state regarding our implementing any of these recommendations. And the committee met last week with Herb Hartman, who is the state director of the Department of Parks and Recreation. And he was very cooperative with us and has indicated that most of what we've recommended the town can probably do. He's agreed that we can limit parking at Stump Cove to commercial fishermen. He's agreed to permit the installation of signs stating the parking restrictions and directing the pleasure boats to the town access road. And I didn't get a firm commitment from him, but I think that the state will pay for these signs. We're going to have to cut back on parking on the beach. In the past, the parking on the beach has been pretty much unregulated. Parking on the beach now is going to be limited to people that need to be there to launch a boat. There'll be you'll only be able to park as far as the access road in from what's the road that comes down Richmond Terrace, and only one row of cars towards the back of the beach. We've asked the state if they would install a light at the end of the parking lot. Mr. Hartman indicated that he could probably find some funds to do that if the town asked him to do that. We asked Mr. Hartman if he could find us some funding for the cost of the parking lot attendant. He's indicated that he would look into that, and he thought there might be some grant money available for that. He's indicated a preference to close the whole area at night, but he's backed off from that. He has asked that the town agree to put a gate across or a chain across the town access area at night. The committee believes that this ought to be done. The reason being that people at night go down onto the beach in their cars. They drive over to the Crescent Beach concession area. In the past, they've broken up benches and destroyed property, had bonfires and the like. And Mr. Hartman thought that it would be a fair trade in exchange for what he's willing to try to do for us, if we would be willing to chain that off at night. I think he'll probably even provide the chain. We've left it with the state that from the town, once the town decides what it wishes to do at Kettle Cove, I will get back to Mr. Hartman and try to work out the details of the possible funding for the attendant, putting in a light if the council wants a light, and providing for and paying for the signs in the Kettle Cove area. That's a brief summary of what we've done and what we've recommended. I'll be happy to answer any questions that the council has or that the members of the public have.
Other Councilor Jordan?
Yeah, just one question. On the Crescent Beach area, you speak of a permit for pleasure boats now, the overflow of the fishermen. If you had a commercial permit, would you be allowed on Crescent Beach?
Yes, the commercial permit would let
any
you...
Any boater on Crescent Beach?
Yeah, any boater with a permit could get onto Crescent Beach. There are a few fishermen that launch their boats off Crescent Beach, and that has not been a problem. The two of them, the pleasure boaters and the fishing boaters, or the fishermen, using that facility, the real problem has been at Stump Cove. But the answer to your question is yes.
Bruce, the light, is that for night use to hold down loitering?
Yes. The suggestion was that a light be put at the far end of the parking lot. And although I haven't had discussions with him, I was concerned that the people that lived up the road might not want a light on there at night. Someone on the committee indicated that they had heard that the people that live there would welcome a light to if that would cut down on what goes on there at nighttime.
Thank you. Any other questions? Are there any questions from the public? Yes, sir.
You're talking about...
Can you go to the microphone because the audience at home can't hear you? And identify yourself, please.
Okay, well, I have an awful lot to say, but I really had a few questions to ask first.
That's fine. Ask your questions now, and then you can say.
All right, thank you. The first question is, what has been the practice in the past? How far down the beach or whatever have they allowed the cars to park and the with the trailers? And how far can they launch boats now? Over to the same Richmond Terrace? Halfway? Where?
To date, it's been pretty much unregulated. I saw some pictures of that somebody on the committee had that of parking on the beach last summer, which there were probably 200 cars there. Many of whom did not need to be there. There were people that were there, that had driven in, parked on the beach, rather than going over into Crescent Beach and paying the entry fee. What we're trying to do is cut down on that type of parking and not let anybody go on the beach that doesn't need to be there to launch a boat.
How many cars would be the maximum that could park there now under the new ordinance?
I don't know, as we have a number, but I would guess that not more than 40 or 50 would fit there.
Are most of the cars that have been there in the past boat launchers?
No, I think that a large number of cars, and I haven't been down there to do any study on it last summer, I just appointed to the committee this year. I think that in the past, a large number of people would drive into Kettle Cove and just park on the beach for beaching activities unrelated to boating. And this is what we're trying to stop. We're trying to cut back on that because that just is not an appropriate place for people to park. They don't need to park there. So the real problem is that if you want to launch a boat, there isn't any place in town to launch a boat except there. And there isn't enough parking in the parking lot for cars with trailers. And people come in and they park all over the place. They park on the lawn, they block each other, and it's a real mess. And they've got to park somewhere. And we don't think that the town ought to expand the parking area down. And so it's not a perfect solution, but it's a reasonable solution. And it's a better situation than we've had in the past.
Okay, what about in-town permits versus out-of-town permits? And could somebody just drive up as a day boater and go in?
What is contemplated is that the residents of the town will be able to get an annual permit for $10. A day permit would be available at the by either a resident or a non-resident at the public safety building. For a fee of $250, that's the fee that's been recommended by the committee. Now that permit would not be available if, at the time he seeks to get it, there's no parking space available on the beach.
But would there be any limit on permits issued per annum or per day or?
There is not contemplated that any that there be a limit on the number of permits, but that the attendant. Would not let anybody park there once the area is full. It would be on a first-come, first-served basis. The fact that you have a permit would not guarantee that you get a right to, that you'll be able to park there any given day.
Now, there's an access road that goes from the public, the building there, the maintenance building, that goes all the way over to the, I believe, the parking area.
Mr. Dussault, excuse me, would you try and talk into the microphone because I don't think you're being heard.
Okay. There's an access road in back of the beach, in back of the primary dune, that runs parallel all the way across. Are you contemplating allowing people to drive in that road and then onto the beach?
The only access that we contemplate using, the only one that the town controls, is the small access road that is just north of the existing parking. The other road, I think, is probably a state road that belongs to the state park. There is a road that comes down from the maintenance building down onto the beach. And one of the things that we have to do is make sure that the parking does not block that roadway.
How about the Richmond Terrace access? Is that to be utilized at all?
That is to be utilized only by the people on Richmond Terrace that have a right to use it today. There'll be no cars driving up and down there from the beach now.
I see. Okay.
Also, Ocean Avenue too goes along the right-of-way too.
Right.
That's right.
Okay. I think that is it for my questions.
All right. Are there any further questions of Mr. Coggeshall before he sits down? Thank you. Oh, we do have one from Chief Pickering.
Interested primarily in the Stump Cove area. What is going to be the prerequisite, or what do you consider qualifications for being a commercial fisherman who I assume is going to have primary access to Stump Cove?
I understand that a commercial fisherman will have a commercial fishing license.
What?
And he'll have a permit issued by the town that will put on his truck or on whatever vehicle he has that will indicate that he's entitled to be at Stump Cove.
So what's the cheapest commercial fishing license that one can buy? How much? Does anyone know? I had heard that you could buy one for as little as $15. And I was wondering what the motivation would be for someone to buy a $10 permit to go off a shallow draft beach as opposed to a $15 license, which might entitle them to go off the area that's created a problem for these gentlemen.
Well, I don't think, Chief, that you're going to see a great deal of effort to get around this. I think that the commercial fishermen in town, people know who the commercial fishermen are. It's not a great launching area in any event, and the only types of pleasure boats that you're going to see a lot of down there, I think, are you're going to see sunfishes and you're going to see some small outboards, but you're not going to see the big pleasure crafts that people keep at the marinas. And I don't think it's for that type of boat. I don't think it's worth paying the extra $15 to try to get into Stump Cove.
A number of people asked me this line, as we were probably the ones that are furnishing the attendance.
Michael?
I think, you know, there would be two requirements. One would be a commercial fishing license, and the other would be that the boat would be commercially registered. Again, that is a lower cost. I think the concern is a very valid one, and you know, I think we're going to have to look very carefully, particularly folks that come in to register boats in Cape Elizabeth from here on out. That those new ones that come in are indeed commercial fishermen, not just being registered as commercial, and that, you know, otherwise, you know, to make sure that they are being used commercially, so to make sure that anyone from this point on is not trying to deliberately evade the policy. If so, then we'll have to come, you know, I think I would recommend more restrictive ordinances at that point.
Let me point out also, Chief, that the recommendation that this committee has made is really a temporary and experimental one, and it's really been stated so with our negotiations with the state. We're going to see how it works, and if it doesn't work, we'll be back in for some changes.
Any other questions of Mr. Coggeshall? Thank you very much, Bruce. Oh, you have another question.
With the beach loaded, with as many cars as can get in there, how many would you anticipate at one time?
I think earlier I said that the maximum number that you could park there probably in that area, one row of cars, is we haven't measured it, but I guess is that you're talking maybe 40 or 50 cars.
Yes, sir. Can you come up to the microphone, please, and identify yourself?
My name's John Kelman. I'm just curious to know what the definition of boaters is for people parking on the beach. Would windsurfers be allowed, or any other people that would need a trailer? Are those people who would be, for whom parking permits would be available?
I think we contemplate that something like a windsurfer, even if it doesn't have a trailer, where it's got to be lugged some distance, or it's heavy if you have to lug it some distance, would be permitted to launch from the beach, yes.
And to park on the beach.
That's correct.
Well, if there are no further questions of Mr. Coggeshall, we'll ask this gentleman to make his statement.
Unfortunately, I haven't been aware of this. I wasn't sure I could make it this evening, so what I really have is some scribbled notes. But first of all, I'd like to just establish what credentials we have. For 15 years, I've been one of the self-appointed chairmen of the Kettle Cove, Seal Cove, Crescent Beach State Park Resident Watchers Association. Lived directly above it on Crescent View Avenue. We've been there for 15 years. We've lived in the Cape over 20 years. My wife has and is serving as Community Services Advisory Committee in about 5 years, and she's the current chairman. I've served on the Zoning Board of Appeals over 5 years, having served several terms as chairman. We have two daughters who've gone through the local school system, and unfortunately, they are certainly qualifying as junior or auxiliary members of the Kettle Cove Teenage Society. And as you all know, the Teenage Society meets nights and weekends, particularly in good weather. And let's see, what else? Oh, yes, my wife is also a charter member in good standing of the Crescent Beach Sunbathers Association. She probably spends more days on the beach during good weather on weekends than few other people in the Cape. So visually, proximity, long-term residency, we care an awful lot about this area that's under question. We have watched with concern in the past the abuses that have happened on the beach. The thing that's appalling to us is supposed to be a state beach where people can come, ample parking is provided, and they can stroll on the beach as they do back and forth. I sure think that more parking is necessary, but to allow the beach to become a full-time authorized parking lot, I think we can really do better for a state park. I appreciate the fact that people have boats, want to get them in the water, but I hardly think the state park beach is the appropriate place to do it. Or if it is, certainly not all the way over to Richmond Terrace Ocean Avenue. That's ludicrous. I don't know what percentage that is of the beach, but it certainly is significant. In fact, I can recall when there was a lobster pound down on the point, and we held our breath until they established the what was then the new parking area and beach concession area down to the other end. And we're quite pleased that that's where it went, since it didn't disturb anybody's view over there, sheltered by the woods, and so on. I don't know what the answer is. Probably total denial is unfair, as well as total acceptance. But I'd like to ask the council to go extremely slowly before this is approved. Just judging from the space, I would have to think that 40 or 50 cars is a serious understatement. I can't really challenge it because I haven't measured it either, but there's a lot of room there. And the constant going and coming and noxious fumes and so forth, it should be held at least to a minimum. As we all know, green space, access to the water, in other words, the natural element, is becoming more and more of a problem. For that to be subjugated, if you will, to allow cars parking on the beach to any great length, seems to me a crime. So what I'd like to ask at the very least is that the area be restricted and that we don't go at least all the way to Richmond Terrace. That certainly seems extreme from somebody who lives right on top of the situation. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan?
Yeah,
question?
Well, I wanted to answer a question perhaps for him. When the state park first became a state park, for the first 6 or 7 years, the state put up a fence just east of the Richmond Terrace Ocean Avenue. And that, on east of that fence, was designated as an area for boaters and boaters to park their cars. So this isn't anything new. It's, I don't know why they stopped putting the fence up every year, but that would have helped. Maybe we wouldn't even have to be here tonight if they had done that right up to date.
The last article I saw in the paper of Mount Crescent Beach talked about 250,000 people a year using the beach. Now, I don't believe they were counting cars on this end. They were counting admissions of families and cars coming in the other way. What I'm saying is if 250,000, a quarter of a million people, and that's what was reported in the paper, are using the beach, then the vast majority are coming, parking in the parking lot, and then using the beach on foot. You know, we enjoy the occasional deer that wander over from the game preserve, the pheasants out in the field, the red foxes. It's a common occurrence. And the last thing we need is more and more cars and more carbon monoxide and more cars stuck in the beach getting their boats in and out. Again, I think some limited access is fair, but all the way to Richmond Terrace, to me, is too extreme.
Yes, sir. Would you come up to the microphone and tell us who you are?
My name is George Knowles. I have been a resident and had a boat on a mooring there for about 40 years, and I know Mr. Duso very well. And I don't think he knows the extent to which the state has agreed to let cars go. I think you're thinking it's about twice as far as the actual. It isn't all the way to Richmond Terrace. There's an access that the people in Richmond Terrace use to drive onto the beach that's about halfway between where I think you think it is and the end of the beach. It's only on the muddy seaworthy end over to the supposedly a stake there now. And it's not all the way over to Richmond Terrace. It's only about half that far.
How far would you guess that space is?
Well, all I know is the man from Augusta who's in charge looked at it himself and the state park director with him, and they estimated maybe 60 cars in one row, and that's all they would consider. And apparently in the past there have been two or three rows some days, recent summer,
so
cars with trailers. There apparently is no possibility of a parking lot behind the sand dunes at all. So it's for the time being, that's what he's agreed to, and he's restricted it to that.
So it would be far less than what's now going on?
I think so. You know, because right now they've gone, at some days they've gone quite a long ways over.
Because of no regulation.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that about where the fence was?
I was misleading, the entrance that comes down onto the beach, not all the way over if you
want. Well, it's a little farther than the parking garage, than the garage facility maybe. A little beyond that. The first way to get down is just beyond the maintenance garage.
Where the old fish shanty used to be.
Yeah, no, it's nowhere near that far. If that helps you, I mean.
Yeah, that does.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to make some comment? If there is no further public participation, then I will declare this hearing closed, and we will move on to item number 71, to consider the preliminary report of the Harbor Advisory Committee. This report was received at the March meeting, and so it's now in order to accept it and to think about implementation. Councilor Torrey?
Madam Chairman, I'd like to move acceptance of the preliminary report and direct the town manager to implement its recommendations.
Second.
Would you like to add Mr. Coggeshall to continue negotiations with the state as he seems to be prepared to do?
Yes, I would. I would urge him to continue the fine negotiations with the state.
With the help of the manager.
For almost everything.
Okay. Second?
I did.
Okay. Councilor Amaral?
Just a couple of questions. First of all, the fees that are being recommended, the $10 fee for a permit, how does that compare with what the cost of getting into Crescent Beach is on an annual basis at this time? Is that less than it? I wondered why the committee decided to go for a fee that was less than what it cost to enter Crescent Beach. Under the state park.
I think the thought of the committee was that...
Bruce, I'm sorry. I know it's been a long day and you're tired. It's the last mile, I hope.
I guess we kind of picked the $10 fee out of the air. We didn't want it to be a fee that was burdensome to anybody, particularly the fishermen. And we thought that $10 would probably cover, you know, a portion of the cost. We really didn't relate it to the cost of getting into Crescent Beach, because the permit isn't supposed to let you use the beach. It's the permit to put your boat in the water, which is really a different use than going in and using the, you know, the state's facilities over at the beach house.
I'm just wondering if somebody could get a permit from the town, which was to launch a boat, but could use that to just drive down.
Well, if you've got your boat with you, yes. If you got to be there launching a boat.
If you put your boat
on your trailer, and go down and park on the beach with your boat and have a picnic, I guess yeah, you could do that. But I don't think we really contemplate that people are going to do that.
So the parking attendant will be able to tell people that they don't have a boat with them.
If they've got a permit, they still can't go down there unless they're either launching a boat or bringing a boat in. Okay.
Councilor Tinsman.
Before Chairman Carpenter leaves, I wanted to make sure that the proposal tonight was to also include the mooring fee, which has been discussed, which relates to a $25 commercial biannual inspected type fee and the residence.
Part of the recommendation included in our preliminary report is to institute a fee for moorings, which is a $25 biannual fee for residents and $100 biannual fee for non-residents. And the recommendation is also that anyone that has a mooring and pays the fee does not pay the fee for the permit.
Councilor Torrey.
One other point of clarification is the recommendation specifically stating about the light, that the light shall be put up by the town manager, and if we pass what I just recommended, would the manager then be instructed to put up a light for this summer or not?
Well, the light was not included in the preliminary report. I think that what your vote ought to be is to permit us to explore that with the state. And if the state will fund it, then go ahead and ask the state to put it up. If you decide that you want a light there.
Okay, I just wanted to make it clear, because I'm opposed to a light, and I just didn't want it to be part of the package that was going through tonight. So that's something that'll be further study, and hopefully we can get, as a council, we can get a little more input on that. So we can debate the pros and cons, because there are some both sides to that issue.
Okay, well, as I said, the way it was left with the state was that the town decides what it wants, and then we'll go back to the state and see which of those things we can get them to provide and pay for.
Okay. Thank you.
Bruce, before you go, would you review the time frame for us? We have here a preliminary report. You're going to be negotiating with the state with the help of the town manager, trying to implement some of your preliminary recommendations. Are you going to have a final report?
I think the appointment of the committee, at the time the committee was appointed, I think the council contemplated that, and yes, I think we will.
Around September, is it? Or?
Hopefully earlier than that.
I would hope that the work of the committee could be finished before September.
Well, it would be helpful to have it completed before the season begins.
Well, there are some other things, Madam Chairman, that the committee is working on besides Kettle Cove. And I think we're pretty well finished up with Kettle Cove, and we can give a final report on Kettle Cove. But the committee is also working on a mooring plan, and working on a new harbor and mooring ordinance. Mm-hmm. And those I don't think need to be necessarily completed by the time the season begins. And I think it would be a mistake to try to rush those. to have them done by June.
Well, that's what I wondered, whether you were gearing towards the season or not.
No, I think that...
But as far as the parking and the use of the beach, the multiple use of the beach...
We want to have all the Kettle Cove issues decided and resolved by the time the season starts. The balance, we're working now with the consultants that are working on the mooring plan, working on the harbor ordinance. And those, the bulk of the work of the committee from here on out will be working on those rather than Kettle Cove.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Amaral?
Bruce, I just wanted to commend you on your negotiations with the state. I think you've done an exceptional job.
Well, I haven't agreed.
On behalf of the town.
Thanks.
Preliminarily.
Particularly
if, in fact, the state is willing to pay for the cost of the attendant, that's a real...
Well, I can tell you that Herb Hartman, who's the director of Parks and Recreation, was extremely helpful and extremely cooperative. We had a very good meeting with him.
Glad to hear that.
Councilor Jordan, I'm sorry. I wasn't looking
your way. No problem. I always yield to the ladies. I would just like to have you point out, Bruce, to the people here that of the time schedule as far as the attendant, one thing, and the time that we're going to have an attendant there.
Well, I think that may be an issue, Councilor Jordan, that you might want to address a little bit. The recommendation of the committee is that, at least the preliminary recommendation is that he be available or be on duty weekends from Memorial Day until the middle of June, and then he be on duty 7 days a week during the summer up until Labor Day. I think there was some discussion at our last meeting, and I forgot who brought it up, somebody had checked with Chief Pickering, and had indicated that we probably don't need somebody there that much of the time, and perhaps during the summer, in the middle of the week, we wouldn't need anybody. And so this, again, we're trying this for the first time. It's experimental, and if it doesn't work, we can change it where we're concerned about the cost, you might recommend that the report be adopted, but give the manager the authority to regulate those hours or change those hours as needed during the course of the season.
One other question, mostly to the manager. The question is, I'm in favor of that light, and I think it'd be a great asset to the area, and I think it would help out in the evenings tremendously. And I'm wondering, is this, as I understand it, could be a separate item here a little later on, after you get done with the negotiations with the state? Or?
Councilor Jordan, if I might respond to that, I would suggest that perhaps you let me go back to Mr. Hartman and see what he's willing to do, and then come back to the council with a further report of our committee with respect to that light.
Okay.
One other thing in response to that, the town council has adopted a street lighting policy. One aspect of that policy is that lights may be placed at dead ends, which that is. Another aspect of the policy is that before any light goes up, residents in the immediate area are surveyed. It would be my plan, working with the chief of police, who now handles street light matters, that we follow the customary procedure adopted by the town council.
So you're going to find out if they want the light before he negotiates with the state?
The chief of police will, yes.
We have a motion pending. Would you like to read it? Could you read it to us, Debbie? It's been a time. Thank you, Bruce.
Voted to accept a preliminary report of the Harbor Advisory Committee and to direct the town manager to implement its recommendation and to include continued negotiations with Mr. Cogshell with the state of Maine.
Are you ready for the vote? All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Jordan.
I wonder, before we go on to this next one, if we should back up and do a little more acting on the very first thing we took up tonight. I don't think we mentioned that there's going to be an election of town council people and school board members on that Tuesday, May 3rd, 1988. And I wonder if that has to be said in public.
Debbie?
We were only talking about the liquor referendum. And it was included in the warrant. What we did was approve the warrant. The warrant included both elections. She did read it.
Are you satisfied?
Well, if they said it, but I didn't think they said it. Sorry.
Well, let's ask the clerk if she's satisfied by our vote.
Yes, that is included in the warrant. It will be included in the minutes.
Good. Thank you. Well, now we will open our fourth public hearing, the sewerage ordinance amendment. And we'll ask Councillor Bill Jordan to make a brief presentation to explain it to us and the public.
This amendment to the sewer ordinance is in section 15-1-4D. And what it is, parts of it is that it's a flow of gallons to the schools, public buildings, commercial, and the infiltration. And what it has in the past, it's always just been in a booklet of design flow and recommendations from the Pullman Water District, and this will put it into the ordinance. And also in this change is a lot connecting to a public sewer served by the South Pullman Treatment Facility, the planning board shall not approve any such connections unless it has received from the engineer document that the proposed increase in flows is within the contract and the capacity with the South Pullman for the utilization of the South Pullman Treatment Facilities. And also there's one other change in 15-1-7, and it has the flows in here, and it says what was stricken out was within the contract capacity of the town use of the South Pullman Treatment Plant. That is stricken, and we have added as two lots connecting to the public sewer served by the South Pullman Treatment Facility within the contract for the capacity under the City of South Pullman utilization of the South Pullman Treatment Plant, consistent with the town's facility plans and public sewer with adequate reserve capacity maintained for the future eligibility connections to lots not presently connected but eligible pursuant to 15-1-4, and that such connection is properly located in size and may lawfully be constructed. Those are the changes, and I would recommend that we adopt these changes.
Second.
Is there any discussion? Oh, no, just a minute. This is a public hearing. Is there any comment from the public? I doubt it very much, listening to that language. If there is no discussion from the public, we will close the public hearing, and we'll have discussion from the council. Councilor Amaral?
I wondered in the gallonage allotted for the school, if the consideration was given to possible new school construction.
Well, I didn't know there was any new construction going on at the time, but there isn't.
There isn't any now, but there are proposals.
There are proposals, but there is room there for addition.
There is.
Yes.
Thank you.
Councilor Latore?
Yes. Once again, just to clarify for the council and the public, the infiltration number, which is 283,000 gallons per day, was arrived at through Hunter Ballou's estimates, through our town engineer's estimates. Is that where that number came from?
Through a study that was done prior to the Southern Cape Elizabeth sewer system being designed by Hunter Ballou Associates, and I believe also by some subcontractors.
Thank you.
Do we have a motion?
That we adopt the
ordinance as proposed. Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? It's unanimous. Item number 73, to consider a request from the Oaks Condominium Association to accept Oakview Drive. Is Mr. Manthorn here?
Should I put this plan up so the public can see it?
Sure.
If they can see it. It was suggested by the town manager that I come before your board before extensive engineering monies were spent to get this project in a proper order so that the town could accept it. And the reason that I came before you is that there are a few variances that would be required by the town in order to get this road accepted by the town. Right at this time, the road is private, and it serves 24 condominiums off Ocean House Road, which is located here. The Oakview Drive is approximately 1,200 to 1,300 feet in length with a cul-de-sac at the end of it. And the variances that I feel would be a problem would be the setback requirements between Building 1 and Building 6 instead of the 30 feet that would be required by the town. We can only come up with 25 or 26 feet for setbacks. And I see that as one of the major problems that we would have to get from the town in order to continue this process. There were some other points that were pointed out in the report that was received back from Hunter Blue, but I do not feel that those are problems. I think they can be addressed. I think that the biggest problem is this is a setback requirement. What else would you like me to say about that, Madam Chair?
Nothing. I was just waiting for the next move. Would Hunter Ballou like to respond to Mr. Hunter is here? Or anyone else from the public?
I could say some of the other items that were pointed out by the Hunter Blue report indicated that some of the private parking would be within the right-of-way, that the drainage ditches, surface drainage ditches that are adjacent to the existing street might cause some problems, although they have not caused any problems to the residents that are there now, and that easements would be required, which we could certainly give to the town, for the detention basin, which is located down on Mitchell Road, down in this area. And I guess that we would be setting some sort of a precedent asking for a acceptance of a private road, a road that was gone before the planning board as a private road, and now we would like to get it accepted as a public road.
Is there anyone, any of the owners in that area who would like to make any comment on this proposal? Mr. Hunter, do you have anything to add?
As Mr. Manthorn said, he has prepared a plan back last fall, which illustrated the roadway at the Oaks as it was constructed and superimposed a proposed 50-foot right-of-way to encompass the road. Just a little background might be helpful. The Oaks condominium project was processed through the planning board as a under the premise that the roadways and all utilities within the condominium would be privately owned and maintained. And that was reviewed by the board that way. And as such, many of the technical requirements for roadway and drainage construction that would be applied to a road if it was going to be a publicly accepted road were waived by the planning board for this particular development, as it has in quite a few developments around town. As Mr. Manthorn pointed out, there is a problem with the space available between the buildings that abut the road. The right-of-way that he has shown on his plan indeed does provide about a 25 or 26-foot setback from the corner of the building to the proposed right-of-way that he has. I believe, as he pointed out, a 30-foot setback would be a nominal type of setback that would be required. By doing that and maintaining the minimum 25-foot setbacks, the actual road as constructed will not fall within the center of the right-of-way that he has proposed. It is skewed over to one side, so in some areas the edge of paving would be either at or within a foot or two of the edge of the right-of-way that he proposes. On the other side, that brings some of the parking areas that should be on private property now would encroach within the right-of-way that he has. And I think perhaps Mr. Leahy could comment on some of the legal implications that there might be for having private parking areas within the right-of-way. I was concerned also that with the snow plowing, of plowing snow from the street off onto private property, perhaps digging up the lawns on private property, could be a winter maintenance problem. Other concerns would be that if the town is going to consider accepting the roadway into public ownership, I think you would also have to accept the sewer that serves the area into public ownership also, and that would require rights of way along the sewer line, which are not shown on Mr. Manthorn's plan. The sewer goes from the development out onto the street. In addition, the drainage system is basically a series of swales and culverts under the road, which carries the drainage around the building to a detention basin that is built between the development and the Mitchell Road. Many of those swales that carry the drainage from the street come rather close to the buildings. I think that if you're going to consider taking the road, then also you would have to have rights of way, and I think inherently you would assume the maintenance responsibilities for the swales that carry the street drainage and the detention basin itself. Those are additional rights of way that would have to be acquired. My concern on those is that many of those probably pass within 4 or 5 feet of the corners of the buildings as they go around, and I think if we were looking at that originally as a public drainage facility, it would have been set back with formal rights of ways that would have given an easier access to the facilities for maintaining them. So I think in summary, the roadway and the utility system in the area was not designed to come into public ownership. The rights of ways were not established to take it into public ownership. And while it certainly can be done at this time, you should understand that the roadways are not going to be centered in the rights of way. You would have to get drainage easements that are going to be very close to the buildings, and you will become involved in the ownership and the maintenance of the detention facilities that are there. In my letter, I also pointed out that if you are going to consider doing that, then I would think a somewhat more detailed as-built survey of not only the roadway but the sewers, all the utilities should be provided to accurately locate all of the facilities and establish the meets and bounds requirements of all the rights of way that would be necessary in order to do this. And I think, as Mr. Manthorn said, he recognizes that there is a considerable amount of cost and effort in doing that, and Probably does not seem appropriate for them to do that unless there is serious consideration by the council of accepting these facilities into the public ownership.
I have a question of Mr. Manthorn, if I may, and we'd appreciate Mr. Hunter sticking around because there may be some more questions for you. You have an association. You said there are how many condos?
Yeah, 24 units.
24 units. And you have an association?
Yes.
Which assesses the owners for maintaining the roads and plowing?
That's correct.
So forth. Are you representing the association? Or
yes. Yes, I am.
Do you have 100% backing, 50%, 70%? What kind of...
It's been brought up at the annual meeting, and everybody that was there wanted me to go forth with trying to get the road accepted.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I think Mr. Manthorn is through. Do you want to identify yourself? He was just answering a question.
Right. My name is Barbara Page, and I'm the president of the association. And I just wanted you to know that unanimously among the owners that were present at the meeting, which I would say would be about at least 85 to 90%, would like to see this road accepted. We were under the impression that down in Cape Colonial Village at one time that it was also a private road system and that things were made to work out. And that's what we would like to do. If there's any possibility, it being that we own our plots and we pay the taxes here, if there's any way that we could work around it, if it's something that's not too insurmountable, I mean, it's something that we can do, we certainly, as a entire group, would like to have it done if possible.
Thank you very much.
When I reported back to the Oaks Condominium Association, I thought that I could meet all of Mr. Hunter's suggestions except for the setback requirement. And I didn't. There was no way that I could meet that requirement. I could not fit a right-of-way between those buildings and maintain a 30-foot setback. And I thought the next step was to come before you people before we went on with further engineering to see the feeling of the town council and whether we should continue or not.
Thank you. It's been, Councilor Jordan?
I wonder, have you seen this list that was from Bob Hunter's?
Yes, I have, yeah. And I feel all those items can be met except for the setback.
Mr. Leahy, was suggested that you might be able to fill us in on legal implications of the town taking over this road.
Madam Chairman, I really hadn't prepared before sitting here this evening, but I think there are complications whenever you do that. Not so much because it's a private road and a private subdivision, but usually the way the condominiums are laid out, the parking is part of the roadway system and just off of the road. So it's hard later to superimpose a right-of-way over it. And that's the end of the right-of-way, and you're right at the end of where somebody parks their car. So it's not, I suppose you could say it would be similar to a driveway, except instead of one driveway, you have all these cars parked at these different offshoots off the road. I think that's difficult, and that's why very few condominiums have public roadways that I know of, simply because it's too hard to have the open parking that way. I think it may be important from the condominium documents, we'd have to go back, but it may be important that we have unanimous approval of the unit owners because it is presently a common element of the condominium. They own the drainage swales, the roadways, what have you. So I'm not sure that can be offered to the town without unanimous approval of the condominium association. So it'd be a first, and I don't think it's, maybe it's not insurmountable. I think there are reasons why it's difficult. It's partly because of the layout. In most condominiums of this nature, the parking is laid out in anticipation of the roads not being accepted as public roads, so they can work out their own parking situations.
Thank you. Michael?
In preparing for tonight's meeting, we discussed this administratively, the Public Works Director, town engineer and myself. And, you know, while certainly we sympathize, you know, with the desires of the residents of the Oaks, you know, in addition to all the technical concerns and actually following through on the technical concerns, we have very much a concern about precedence in waiving certain standards at this point, and particularly setbacks. I think, you know, the main issue with the setback is simply the way that it was laid out in the preliminary design by Mr. Manthorn. There was absolutely no setback from the road. The edge of the road was the edge of the right-of-way. No place at all to put snow in a certain area, and there were a number of concerns. But we then began to look, you know, say you did waive it, say, you know, you wanted to do something. Where are you opening the door, particularly, you know, when you don't, by waiving, you're practically eliminating all standards. We made a quick list of some of the areas that might possibly come into the town council. Wildwood, Cape Woods, Canterbury of the Cape, Great Pond Terrace, Cranbrook Drive, Belfield Road, Hubsville. All of those are now paved and, you know, are very similar in nature, although some are condos, some are single family, to the Oaks. In addition, we have a number of roads that aren't paved, but that are also private roads. All of Elizabeth Farms, I want both, all phases, all of Delano Park, Dave Carley Road, Ocean Avenue, Richmond Terrace, all of McKinney Point, Tides Edge Road, Beacon Lane, Peebles Cove, Surfside Road, Deer Run Road, Woods Knoll Road, Leiden Lane, Kaputik Drive. I could go on with others. But, you know, I think the town has traditionally stood for certain requirements. You recently enacted subdivision regulations having certain requirements. Would like to say that of late, on the administrative end, we have been very much advocating the planning board to accept roads up front as public roads. Mr. Wainwright was here. He first came in with Wainwright Drive with the thought that it might be private. We advocated to be public. He agreed to that. We did the same thing with Stonegate. That originally, you may recall, came to the planning board as private. You know, we have no feeling that, you know, that the taxpayers, you know, ought not to get their full share of services. It's just that these things ought to be done right up front with the proper standards so that residents don't get saddled with the problem, you know, like I think these particular residents have. So, you know, for all the reasons Mr. Hunter stated, and particularly because of those reasons, not establishing a precedent with all these streets and certainly other areas, Bob Malley, Bob and I all felt that we should regretfully decline the offer of acceptance of the roads.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
In listening to all of this, I take it the road is built to the town specifications at the time as far as an accepted road? The base, pavement, so on and so forth?
Yes, I believe the depth of gravel and the paving of the structural buildup of the road was in compliance with the town standards, and I drove over the road this afternoon, and the road has held up well from a structural standpoint. There were no deficiencies in the road, and I think the paving is in good shape, and there's been no structural failures at all.
So evidently they built it according to a accepted street at the time?
They did, as far as the gravel base and the paving buildup was built to the town standards. The area that it did not comply with the town standards is basically in the layout and the geometrics of it, as Mr. Leahy said. It was designed and laid out as a condominium type of development where the roadways and utilities were to remain in private ownership. So in that case, there was no formal roadway right-of-way established, and the parking areas and the geometrics were set to make it as convenient as possible to lay the parking in. Now when you go in and superimpose a right-of-way on top of it, it just doesn't fit too well, and so it's a geometric problem primarily as far as the road goes.
Okay, I understand that. Now, is the sewer in the street all the way through the project?
The sewer is in the street partway through the project. It goes across the private land between the end of the where it leaves the street and goes out onto Mitchell Road. So part of it is within the street, and part of it is not within the street.
Just the part that goes out to Mitchell Road is not in the street, the rest of it is in the street?
That's correct, yes.
So if the road is accepted, we accept the sewer at the same time?
I believe you do, although there may be some legal distinction on it, but I would think if you accept the road, you accept the utilities that are in the road, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Latore?
Just again, it's one point of clarification for me. We're certainly hearing a lot of evidence on both sides, but for Mr. Manthorn, if this obviously was designed from the very beginning to be private, went to the planning board as private, why at this juncture are we being asked to accept it as a public road? What was the change that was resultant in your being present tonight?
I would say that when the Oaks Condominium Association met, the cost of maintaining that road, snow plowing in particular, is quite high, and yet there's no break in the taxes to take care of that. So I believe I suggested that we ought to attempt to get this accepted as a public road. And then I went and did the as-built where I located the buildings and the pavement accurately, put it on paper, and I felt that there was a chance that we could come before this board and give it a shot. You know, there's some parking that appears, I only see really one parking lot that appears to be within the right-of-way that could be a problem, and I'm sure that the Oaks Condominium Association, if it was necessary, would move that one parking lot. The other statement would be that some of the snow would be plowed onto private land, and that's true, but easements can be obtained to handle that. Easements would be obtained for the sanitary sewer to be put out to Mitchell Road. Those things are done all the time.
Mr. Manthorn, when people are making the decision to purchase one of the condos, are they told approximately how much it would cost them per year for maintenance of the road and plowing? Do they ask? Do they know?
Yes,
are they informed?
Well, that's a fact that has to be given to a person that buys a house. He has to know what the association dues per month are.
So they buy the condo knowing that those expenses go along with it.
That's right.
I feel very strongly about the precedent setting. even though I live in one of those private areas, and I know my neighbors would love to have me really favor what you're asking and hopefully expand it into other areas, but it would be tremendously costly to the town to start a snowballing of this kind of thing. You understand that?
I understood that I was coming in with a precedent, yes. I knew that it would cause some problems, but, and I told the Oaks Condominium Association that, and I still felt that we should carry forth and see what the town council said about it. And then we would go back and discuss it further if necessary.
Councilor Jordan.
I suggest that we table this item until maybe this group can meet these concerns and come back to us. If they can meet all these concerns that our engineer has and our public works director has, and then...
Are you making a motion? Because
yes,
it's not debatable.
Did I make a motion to table?
Is there a second?
To table for any length of time or indefinitely or...
The table until they can come back and assure us that they can meet all these concerns that that our town engineer and the public works director have given us.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Opposed? 5-2. Do you have your hand up? To vote, or?
Well, I did the vote, and I kept it.
And now you want to make a statement. Councilor Tinsman.
I guess whether or not we're setting a precedent here is not paramount in my mind. I think if an association decides at some point in time that
up until now, private road, a private way is petitioned to be a public way if they can meet the standards and in effect at the time that they ought to have the chance to do that. And I guess I would say, from my perspective anyway, that if this association can meet the standards that are in effect today, the acceptance of this road like we would any road, whether it exists today or not, that they ought to be able to give it a shot. The unfortunate part is that my opinion probably won't matter, because the time it takes to put this all together, I probably won't be sitting here. And I think there's three of us in this position, whether or not we agree or disagree. And that, if nothing else, unless it gets shot down tonight, that perhaps you wait until a new council is seated, perhaps answer some of those questions that are of concern tonight, and resubmit it. Because I'm not sure just what sort of time frame you're looking at to do the type of engineering to meet the concerns of the town, but it may be more than the 2 months that three of us will be sitting here. And I just wanted to say that I'm not opposed to it. They can meet the standards, and I think they ought to have a shot.
Are you asking us to table it so they can meet the standards?
I wasn't suggesting anything except that Mr. Manthon might find it to his advantage to withdraw his proposal tonight. And depending upon the thoughts coming from the rest of the council, we'll see
it later. Councilor Amaral?
I guess I could disagree with you, Doug, because I really feel that it's very important policy that we would be making by allowing this road at this point to come before us. It went through the planning process as a private road. And as a result of that, the same requirements were not necessary as if it had gone forward as a public road. So I think if we're going to allow in-town private roads to be built, that it should be a very rare occasion that they come back to us to become public roads. In fact, I talked to a councilor from a neighboring community today who said that in their town they have decided now not to allow any private roads at all in new developments, just because of this kind of thing occurring. I think it would be next to impossible after a subdivision like this has been built to meet all the requirements that would have been required if it had been submitted as a public road initially. So I'd have a very difficult time, unless there was some unbelievable extenuating circumstances to even consider this project.
Do you have a motion?
Yeah, I'd like to move that we table this item indefinitely.
Second.
Any further discussion?
No discussion.
All those in favor? Opposed? 6-1.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. We'll take a 5-minute break.
Table indefinitely.
Probably I can crucify
myself. They can still meet all the time.